Welcome to CareTalk, America's home for incisive debate about healthcare business and policy. I'm David Williams, president of Health Business Group.
And I'm John Driscoll, the CEO of CareCenter. David, why are we still at Health 2021? Enough already. What's up next? What could we possibly have left? Not who to talk to, what to talk about? Inform me.
Here's the thing. We have Dan Mendelson here, and now he is moving on up in the world. Not that he wasn't
Absolutely.
In a high stature before when we spoke to him at Avalere.
He's dressed better now.
Inovalon. Well, you won't be able to see that unless we have a good photo along with this show. But he's now CEO of Morgan Health, and it's a serious stuff, John, so let's take it seriously for once.
Okay. Well, welcome, Dan. Thanks for coming back to the show. Tell us a little bit about what does Morgan have to do with J.P. Morgan, and what is J.P. Morgan in healthcare? What does it all mean? I mean, it's we were earlier today we were talking about Walmart, and I think Marcus ably defended the role of Walmart in health. I mean, how can J.P. Morgan and your new venture really help us meet the challenges of healthcare today?
Well, first, let me thank you guys for having me again on the show. I'm a repeat offender, and it's always fun to subject myself to your abuse. So I appreciate it. Thank you. John, to your question about kind of why is J.P. Morgan Chase in this? Look, the company spends about $1.7 billion a year on healthcare. And it's a very traditional indemnity model today. There's no accountability for outcomes. There's no accountability for costs. And, you know, we got to believe that we've got health equity issues along with everybody else. So I think that, you know, it's incumbent on a company like J.P. Morgan Chase to try to do better. And that's really where it all starts.
But can an employer really make a difference?
Yeah. I think an employer can make a difference by holding its partners accountable to make sure that there's an acceleration of progress. And look, you know, we, after thinking about this carefully, there are a lot of things that we can't do. We can't price drugs. We can't and won't ever force people into programs of care that they don't want to go into. This is really intended to improve outcomes and also to improve retention and, you know, many other things, but there are many ways that we can improve. The first that we're focused on is accountable care and really bringing a lot of those concepts of accountable care into the employer context where, you know, they've proven successful in Medicare. Why not use them over here?
So it looks like you have three areas of focus. So even though you can't do everything, it's a pretty broad remit, and it's not obvious to how the three things go together. Is it too ambitious? And, you know, does one kind of rise to the top out of those three?
Well, yeah. What are they? David, you referred to three, like we're
supposed
to know.
Well, I wanted to see, in consulting, there's always three things, so it warmed my
heart.
There
have to be three,
yeah,
exactly.
So I'll tell you what I read, and then maybe Dan can inform us
a little
better.
Can correct you, deepen
it. Yeah,
that's
so
fine.
Play the guessing game.
$250 million toward health system improvement. That's the first one. The second, enhanced health benefits for employees. And the third is promoting healthcare equity. So those seem to me to be fairly diverse set of goals and pretty big and broad. And I think a danger of overreach and disappointment in the $3 trillion healthcare system or $4 trillion or $5, whatever it is by the time we're done with it.
All right. Well, okay, first, I don't know who's writing your talking points, but let me kind of reframe a little bit here. We go into this with a focus on employer-sponsored healthcare. So we are not going to be investing in Medicare, Medicaid, you know, kind of related issues, core technology, those kinds of things. So, you know, that's kind of all off the table. In terms of what we are trying to accomplish, improvements in outcomes as measured by standard measures, diabetes, cardiovascular, cancer screenings, and the like, the ones you're familiar with. Number two, a mitigation in the rise in costs. So we're not looking, you know, necessarily to see total cost of care plunge. I think we're all jaded enough to not believe that that's going to happen in the immediate future. And then the third is just to address these health equity issues that we know exist. We have $250 million from the balance sheet to invest, but not everything that we do will require investment. So, for example, just last week, we closed a collaboration agreement with Kaiser Permanente, where we're going to work collaboratively with Kaiser to identify any disparities in care that exist in our population on race, ethnicity, and to address them over time. So, you know, there are very specific, concrete things that we're going to do. So we will not, none of us believe that due to our efforts, it's going to be like this transformational thing that the entire healthcare system is going to turn around. But yet we do believe that our participation in this will make a difference, and we'll be able to accelerate progress like, you know, we did with Kaiser.
And when you think about that, Dan, you know, I do think that, you know, you bring the benefit of having been at the peak of government around, you know, how we're spending money when you were in the White House, of consulting to some of the great organizations in the United States to get, you know, deep analysis and analytics around what works and what doesn't. And now you represent an employer, and employers, I think, can be and have historically been more aggressive about arguing the sort of the poor return on investment or no return measures or no metrics and no accountability. And it's been enormously frustrating. Pacific Group on Health, all the different employer coalitions have pushed it. What's going to be different this time? In 5 years from now, what would you like your most ranked achievements in terms of accountability? Because I do think, you know, JP Morgan as a brand and as an employer is really well positioned if you can drive that through. But to your point, you can't boil the ocean. So what do you focus on, and where do you think you can what do you think that legacy is going to be like?
So this really, you're asking the questions that were really core to our whole strategic planning effort when we first launched this. And I'll say a couple of things. First, we are an investor. We have $250 million from the balance sheet to invest. We will invest in companies where we believe that we can meaningfully accelerate their progress. What does that mean? It means, first of all, we have great staff. They come out of the Innovation Center. They come out of investing. We have really outstanding expertise in health equity on the staff now. So, you know, we have that intellectual property. We have the JPMC financial acumen. We have $1.6 to $7 billion a year that we spend on healthcare to leverage as well. The other interesting thing about the JPMC environment is that about half of our population is concentrated into 7 geographic areas. So we have these natural test beds. So for example, in Columbus, Ohio, we have 38,000 employees and dependents. And we chose that as our first area to test an advanced primary care model and to move to full risk because of the fact that we have that population. We're the largest commercial insurer in Columbus. And we also happen to have a really outstanding primary care practice there that has been successfully taking full risk in Medicare. And so, you know, if we can put those assets together and do something meaningful in Columbus, I think, David, to your point about, like, well, why are you going to be successful? It's really that we will adjust the expectations down. We're not planning to do this countrywide initially. We're taking geographies where we know that we can make a difference and applying our energies there. And
so clearly, you know, JP Morgan has been concerned about healthcare for some time, and the previous effort involved working with two other companies in Haven to try to change things. That didn't work out so well. Are there specific lessons that JP Morgan derived from that are informing what you're doing now?
Right. Three lessons. So first is simplified governance is good. That's the one that you just referred to. You had three companies that had very different ideas about what they wanted to accomplish, and governance in that context is impossible. Second is that we are going to be approaching this in partnership with outstanding companies on the outside. So we are not going to hire programmers. We are not going to try to build this from scratch. The approach is very practical, and that's why investment capital, you know, is the way to do that, because then we can sit on the board and help to direct the efforts and make sure that they're congruent with our values. And then I'd say the third thing is that there were a couple of successful projects that Haven did that really didn't make the radar screen, but they were really thoughtful.
Nothing made the radar screen.
No. Oh, John.
John. But you know, so for example, they did a number of really interesting projects in primary care. And we used the results of that to have primary care be a major focus. So look, you know, we we're certainly very interested in virtual care and how that gets integrated in, but for our kind of pilot in Columbus, it's going to be advanced primary care and it's going to be physical in addition to digital.
And when you think about, you know, primary care, I guess as you think about your investment agenda, you know, it's hard to talk about what you might invest in next, because if you say that as JP Morgan, the price will go up. But are there models that you see around the floor or around the country at Health 2021 or elsewhere mm-hmm. that you would have liked to have invested in if you were doing this 5 years ago?
Yeah. Look, a lot of companies that we're talking to are here at Health 2021, which is one of the reasons that I'm here. The other reason, by the way, I want to come back to, which is we had a great panel with Liz Fowler this morning. I don't know if either of you had a chance to catch it, but, you know, there are a lot of lessons we can work back and forth, you know, public, private, with CMS, but, you know, we can come back to that one. But on the company front, we're very interested in advanced primary care and coordinated care, number of companies in that. We're interested in care navigation. So, you know, can you use algorithms and analytics to help educate consumers about where they should be seeking care and what the cost of that is going to be? So that's another one.
To the Accolade, Grand Roundsy companies like those.
Absolutely. Those companies which are established through Quantum in there as well. And then
Quantum's great, yeah.
And then also kind of all of the smaller ones. You've got a lot of interesting companies. Well, Right Way, 98.6, you know, a little bit more scrappy and young, but experimenting with technologies that perhaps are even a little bit more advanced than some of the established players. So those are companies that we're very interested
in.
Really
exciting.
And then, look, when you look at our benefit, about 25% of our cost is drugs. And it goes up more rapidly than other things. And then, you know, there's kind of a whole tsunami of cell and gene therapy costs that are just kind of sitting off in the ether there, and we're focused on that. We're concerned about that. It's not going to be our first focus because it is 25% as opposed to the 75%, but we will definitely be starting to look at companies that have better approaches to kind of drug management, and that's something that we're very interested in getting into.
Are we going to get JP Morgan to endorse the federal government negotiating drug prices for the Medicare program? We actually got a blue CEO on the record yesterday is saying he's given up on the current system, and the United States has to negotiate with Big Pharma. You've been on both sides of that, both on the board of Coventry of Health Plans. You've been in the White House. What say you?
I mean, look, I say, first of all, the answer to your question is no, that we are not going on record saying that, you know, the government. I mean, frankly, having sat at White House OMB, I hesitate a little bit because I know that the government isn't so great at negotiating prices.
Doing a great job at the Pentagon.
Commercial entities. Yeah, exactly. You know, and do we really want healthcare to be a cost-plus world? I don't think we do. You know, and so look, I think that there's a whole range of things that should be done. So, you know, for example, we should have better data on the value of medications for our population, for Medicare, for Medicaid. It'd be great to get the information, just like European countries do. I mean, so why don't we start there? But I think, again, you know, we are focusing on the things that we can control, not, you know, who's going to be setting the prices for drugs. I think we, you know, when it comes to drugs, we are more concerned about how they fit into the care map and whether the distribution costs are reasonable than we are how the prices are actually being set.
So let's talk about public-private partnerships. And you mentioned your panel from this morning, and clearly you've been inside government, you've been in the private sector. You mentioned even, you know, JP Morgan's not going to try to tackle everything by itself. How can the private and the public sectors work together? What was the discussion like this morning?
Yeah, so first, we're interested in the same things that Liz is at the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation.
Liz is the director of CMMI.
Liz Fowler, right. Thank you. You know, they want to drive more accountability into Medicare. We want to drive more accountability into commercial insurance. One of the things we've been talking with them about is geography, specific geographies, you know, because I think one of the reasons why we are likely to be successful in Columbus is that we're working with a practice, Central Ohio Primary Care, that has been taking risk in Medicare for many, many years, you know, and so they have that experience. And, you know, frankly, I don't think that you could go in on a naive basis to a primary care practice or really any practice and have them take risk in a year and a half if they hadn't had a long experience. So we benefit from Medicare having done that. And to the extent that we can coordinate geographies, that's great. Another example is our work on health equity. You know, in this place, we're ahead of the federal government because while they have a very strong interest in setting up payment for closure of gaps, if you will, in health equity, that takes a long time
current
to do in government.
Current report card would say they're doing nothing. I mean, they really haven't put incentives out there because they say they don't have the data. Yeah. Now, how are you doing?
Well, John is really Debbie Downer this afternoon.
You got to call the balls and strikes, dude.
Don't have
go
a,
Sox.
I think you had a, you know, must have had your decaf on the coffee break today.
Let's get back to our guest, David.
Sure. So let's give him something else other than Jesus and the world going hell. Dan, please confirm.
We were just commenting on the fact that the current administration has clearly laid out a health equity agenda that's all questions and no answers. And I think that Dan is making he claims that J.P. Morgan is making progress on this faster than the government.
Now I'm claiming.
Well, we don't have the data yet. You're a data guy.
The thing is, before he said he's not going to go on the record. And the thing is, he doesn't realize how good our editors are. And that word not can be clearly taken out. So watch out.
It's all good. Look, actually, you know, one of the reasons why I'm excited about this job is that we're very committed to making sure that our successes and our failures will be public. And so, you know, the idea is really to give as much information about what we're doing as possible. And if things don't work, that's fine. I mean, we're a laboratory, just like CMMI is a laboratory, you know, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation.
I'd love to probe a little bit around, you know, there's, I mean, what's shocking about the health inequity data is how it is systematically, even for, if you control for income, education, profession, the disparities around race and ethnicity are stark, and they're not shrinking.
Are you shocked that there's discrimination in America?
What I'm shocked at is I think of physicians having predispositions towards race and ethnicity as filters, but even if it's access to pain meds or access to the best cancer drugs, it is materially clear that race and ethnicity drive poor selection and poor service. I mean, Serena Williams had to fight to get to for anyone to take her pregnancy issue seriously. She almost bled out. And that is much more common among people of color who are bearing children than not. And it's really intriguing to me that you've taken that stand. But how are you going to work to make progress given, because you also have, in addition to having a concentrated population, you've got a population all over the place.
Right. So you very well articulated exactly why we're in this and why we're doing this. So now kind of what tools and methods do we bring? Our tools and methods need to be multifaceted, just like the problem is multifaceted. So first thing I'll say is, you know, I was on the Coventry Healthcare Board of Directors when star ratings in Medicare, the quality payments, went from being something that, you know, you measured and you forgot about to being the basis of payment. And what happened in, you know, 2007 is that, if I'm getting my date right, is that they went from being, you know, nothing to essentially determining whether you're going to have a profitable plan or not. And so in our relationship with Vera, we have an agreement with them that we will start to pay on the basis of disparities. So if there are disparities, they will ultimately have poorer economics than if there aren't. And that is important. So that's kind of one. It's not going to fix everything. A second area
it's a major step forward, though, and that's the first time.
You've got to pay. If you pay for quality, you get what you pay for, because we all know that providers follow incentives, health insurance plans follow incentives, we all follow incentives, let's face it. And so, you know, we will get all sorts of creative ways to reduce disparities if it drives the economics of plan payment. And so that's, you know, what we're interested in doing. And look, it's easier for us to do that than the federal government, or at least it's easier for us to do it more rapidly. And that's the kind of thing that, frankly, you know, my friends at CMS are happy that we're leading here, because then they can go back and say, hey, look what's happening in the private sector. So that's kind of an example of a place where perhaps we can help them a little bit.
So, Dan, last time we had you on the show, we were actually talking about some analysis that you had overseen on the Avalere side related to what CareCentrix is doing. And I am curious about your thoughts about, I think the data was from pre-pandemic, and I'm wondering your thoughts about how, you know, those results might have been influenced by the pandemic, whether they would have held up. I realize it's speculative, but was just had that on my mind.
So, look, you know, I think that it's fair to say that those kinds of results, and if I'm remembering, do you want to say a little bit about
what we found is that, you know, really building on coaching, navigational tools, algorithms, by looking at disparities and gaps in care in the post-acute, that's what happens to you after you get discharged setting, we believed that we weren't just lowering costs and readmissions for our members who were in our 90-day program, that if we got it right, caregivers, care providers, and patients would be reconnected to healthcare in a different way, and that there was, you know, there was an economist, or a doctor rather, who'd worked in Medicare, Dr. Roy Beveridge, who was a colleague of yours, who was the former CMO at Humana, who said, "I think this is worth researching because if you're right, and what I see in the short-term data is right, that changes the arc of chronically ill patients' experience in the healthcare system, and could lead to lower costs and better outcomes." And what we What you found, I mean, you can walk through the data, but what was remarkable is that 9 and 12 months out, once you'd actually built those bridges back to better care, there were material reductions in total healthcare costs, and much more important, the burden and pain of chronic illness.
So these are exactly the kinds of results that we are interested in, and kind of improving the care map. And look, a hypothesis is that these results also hold up in the employer sector in areas where employer costs are at risk. So, you know, post-acute care is the costs are highly concentrated in federal government programs. So we're looking at application of similar tools and methods in areas of concentration of cost for employed populations, whether they be back pain or post-surgical engagement or labor and delivery, you know, because our costs are concentrated in different places. So no doubt in my mind that the results hold up pre and post-pandemic, and no doubt in my mind that we need to be using this kind of work as an analogy to the kinds of things that we're focused on at Morgan Health.
One thing I'd add, at least the insight that I've seen, Dan, is the quality of the coaching and of the culture of the participants that are trying to kind of remap the emotional connective tissue and support for whether it's someone with chronic heart failure or COPD or a high-risk labor and delivery really is critical. And one of the things that I think is a little bit soulless about these industry conferences is it's much more about the tech than the heart. And I think that one of the things that I know you'll hold close to as you look for these models, but that we've built CareCentrix around, and I think drove the results, is the culture of the people was as powerfully important as our analytics and our technology and our network stuff.
You know what's interesting? I got a question earlier today from a reporter asking, like, is it hard to recruit good people to Morgan Health because of what happened at Haven? Just kind of, you know, David, too,
yeah.
You know. And the answer is no, because now that we have kind of the mission aligned and we know what we're about, what we're attracting is a group of people who are passionate about taking another shot at this, you know?
And can't give up.
And so, like, where else, you know, we have the mission is aligned, it's clean, we have very strong support from the CEO on down, wide support as well, you know, from the entire operating committee of the company, $250 million to invest, a practical remit, you know, and so, yeah, it's a tough problem, but we feel a high level of confidence that we can succeed.
Well, you guys have given me a great headline for this episode, you know, bulge bracket bank brings soul back to healthcare. Oh. Gotta love it.
Give soul a chance, David. Ooh. You'll enjoy it. Heart matters.
I am enjoying it, John. In any case, that's it for this edition of Care Talk. I'm David Williams, President of Health Business Group.
And I'm John Driscoll, the CEO of CareCentrix. Thanks for listening, and please subscribe. And Dan, thanks for joining, and we look forward to hearing more and seeing you close gaps, reduce costs, and lift up this country's healthcare system. Maybe a bank can finally help.
Bring
Thanks
a hanky.
Joining.
Bring a hanky. Bring a hanky to the next episode.